Oh my God. Where'd the snowman go? The snowman has vanished. Has he melted? No, he's back, folks.
Snowman.
What kind of shirt's that, snowman?
It's a little Bring the Fire t-shirt.
Ooh.
For the Tiffin Dragons.
I like it.
You got to do it up every once in a while, man. You got to do it up
every once in a while. A little fancy sauce. Got my little fancy thing here. A little fancy, fancy.
Yeah. 16
Sundays in Hell, week 13. So week 13?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we played 12 games with the bye. Week 13, Browns, yep. Titans. The snowman is joining me. I think we're going to keep doing this. I'm tired of riding solo, Jason Derulo style. So the snowman is joining, and it is a joyous Sunday. Not quite a Sunday in hell.
No, no.
Kind of the opposite.
The score, couple more ball games like this, and we turn it into 16 Sundays in heaven.
And, you know, 16 more of those, we're in business.
Yeah, yeah.
So what let's just so the Browns win 41-35 today. The score is a lot closer than the game was, especially that first half. Snowman, before we kind of get into the details of everything, can you just what's your initial reaction and takeaways from today's game?
Yeah, well, I wrote down some notes at the end of halftime, right?
Yeah.
What I kind of thought about the first half. And as the second half is going on, I'm trying to think about what I want to write down and, what I want to talk about here. This game was really just a one-half ball game.
Yeah.
And, it was, 38-7.5?
Yep.
And the game was over. Like, I think every halftime, analyst guy, on Fox, NFL, whatever, they just said, this game's over. Titans can't come back from this. Like, they ended up making a pretty good push there. But, just that deficit at halftime is just – almost insurmountable.
Yeah, absolutely. And the reason that it got so close, we saw this with the Cowboys game, the Browns being up a ton at halftime. The Browns were conservative, as they should be on offense with that big of a lead. You want to keep it on the ground. You want to keep that clock moving. You would have hoped they would have put up some more points, at least get some more first downs than they did in the second half. And, on defense, it's kind of an in-between tricky area because obviously they're not trying to get beat deep. So, Tannehill had a field day in the second half. They completed a lot of passes. There were a lot of times where, I have no idea and we have no idea what the defensive game plans are. I don't know if they were just bad matchups or guys, are passing guys off and they're just not communicating because a lot of guys ran pretty open, not just like guys, not just playing deep and keeping guys in front. There just seemed on some play action stuff. There were some guys running pretty open that we just did not see in the first half. At all. So they were obviously playing very soft coverage on defense. And that fumble at the end, thank God for Kareem Hunt running them down, forcing them to waste some more time before they eventually ended up scoring a touchdown. And Andy Janovich, who had a fullback assist today, also getting it done on the hands team, fresh off the COVID list. So, if Baker didn't do what he did, he's your MVP for the game. that was the second half. So now we kind of one more thing I want to talk about. What I didn't like about the second half was the penalties. In all three phases, there were penalties. There were holding penalties on offense. There were, there were punts where it's like coming back because, there's a hold over here and someone blocked in the back over there. And on defense, jumping off sides, a couple of, I know we always talk about, oh God, like really, is that really a penalty on like the one Zendejo interception? But those are the rules, and those have been the rules for a long time with hitting up around the head. You just can't do that. Kevin Johnson or whoever the defensive back was that hit the receiver up high, like you just have to know you can't do that. So I thought the Browns, that's what I didn't like. I thought they were sloppy, especially to start. I mean, the Titans scored like in three plays to start the second half.
You never want that. I mean, that's just the worst because, you come in the halftime, 38-7 lead. You're like, all right, we're going to be a little bit more conservative. You're not going to go out and you're not going to be throwing 75-yard bombs.
Right.
But at the same time, you're thinking, all right, we got to limit them, limit them to the things they don't want to do, which, in all honesty, is throwing the ball, which is, that's why it was just so over at halftime.
Right.
Yeah, he came out and was – he. You just never want to see teams score in three plays or two plays or whatever it ends up being. That is not good.
Yeah, they came out flat. I mean, because, you know, ideally the Browns, you know, with the, even though it's weird that the Browns don't play with a huge lead, they're really, really good in tight games, which is interesting because you would think with a huge lead, as good as they run the ball, now, obviously the teams even more so know that the run is coming, so they really, really load up the box. But the way that they run the ball and can keep the clock moving, and there's no pressure on the defense, and you know Tannehill's just going to be dropping back to pass. You would think that would be a field day for Myles Garrett, and I know no Denzel Ward, but you know you would think some of those guys in the secondary, you know, could make some plays. They did get an interception today. Got a couple turnovers today, which was huge. But you would think that would be a recipe for success the way that the Browns are built. But you saw it with the Cowboys, and then today. You know, with those big leads, it gets – now, this one wasn't as uncomfortable as the Cowboys game, even though the scores – the Cowboys score was a little more of a differential because the late Beckham touchdown. But it's weird. It's – I just kind of saw it coming. I'm just like, this is just going to be kind of a weird second half.
Yeah, no, when it went to 17-7. We were up 17-0, and they scored, like, so easily.
Yeah, like, they're like, we're going to throw the ball, and they went right down the field.
I think that was like a three-play drive too, and they scored. And that was when I'm like, well, this might be a game. This is going to turn into a game. You know, this is what everybody was expecting. You know, they expect this is supposed to be the best game of the week, you know, not a whole lot of other great matchups. This is the, you know, marquee matchup. And, you know, they come out 17-0. They score. You're like, okay, they're settled in, you know, whatever. But, you know, Cleveland we just kept pounding them, absolutely pounding them physically. I thought it was just, you know, Henry was a complete non-factor.
No.
I think he finished with like 60 yards, but.
Right. I mean, they completely.
They were invisible yards.
They turned them over. They stuffed them on 4th-and-1. They stuffed them on a 2-point conversion. So, I mean, obviously they were out of their game plan. You know, his numbers don't necessarily, you know, because it wasn't in the normal game plan. Obviously they had to throw the ball way more than they usually would. But still, he was a complete non-factor when the game was still a game in, you know, early on there in the first quarter and a little bit of the second quarter before the Browns blew it open. But that's enough of the negative because there's so much positive to talk about, especially with our quarterback Baker Mayfield. So let's just talk about, you know, what you saw from Baker today and what this means for him, because the way that everyone's talking, you know, if everything works out according to Colin Coward's theory, that this was whether the Browns make him the quarterback or not, Baker made himself probably like at least $100 million today.
Absolutely. So here's my take on quarterbacks like Baker. Okay. And, you know, I put Baker in the tier of like Ryan Tannehill and, you know, some of those lower to mid-level guys.
Yeah.
He's obviously not Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers, Drew Brees, those guys. I'm a big believer of a guy of like his talent and his, you know, ability. Start him off quick. Start him, you know, the quick passes, which is exactly what they did. The first play of the game, a little sticker out to Jarvis, you know, just a nice 8-10 yard catch. Just easy stuff. You get him going, you do a couple of those in a rhythm. And then, you know, after it's a mind thing. It's a mindset thing. You, as a quarterback, you see 3, 4, 5 completions in a row. And then, you know, it's just – you're just confident. And that's when, you know, you pull those double moves out and you're throwing dimes and you're throwing deep crossers, you know, the stuff that he did. And I thought he did a really good job today of doing that. It's just, you know, last couple of weeks where he's kind of struggled has been the accuracy part. But he came out today and just really, really put the ball on the money and, you know, ended up doing really well.
Right, and I don't think this is a fluke. You know, the commentators who obviously meet with the coaches and quarterback and things like that, they were talking about, especially the bye, they kept talking about how, you know, not only just for where the Browns were at, but also where their health was at. The bye really just came at a perfect time. You get that extra week for Nick Chubb, and all of a sudden he's back. A couple other guys come back. And then, you know, even though they were coming off of a loss, you know, we also forget that the Browns had a completely new staff come into the building. Well, they didn't even really come into the building because of COVID. Right. And so they're still trying to build that rhythm and that relationship between Stefanski and Baker. And you can see now that they're really starting to catch a rhythm. Because I was, you know, when we were talking, even last week against Jacksonville, Baker missed some wide open guys, but he also.
And that is what we've talked about it so many times, because I up to this date, have hated Baker this year. I, you know, I gave him the pass last year with Fredward Kitchens, the worst football. Yeah, the worst football coach of all time.
Freddy Face.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, we gave him that pass. And then, you know, we come into this year, and he just wasn't, like, producing and performing to what, you know, we thought. But the annoying part that just absolutely – that drove us crazy, you and I both, we've talked about it. The fact that he would show us that he is capable of having games like this.
Yeah.
And making the throws that he's got to make and making the, you know, the plays, making the right reads, all that stuff. And then he would just have terrible throws that would just – totally negate every good thing that he really did because it would just be such a bad pick. And, you know, today he finally put it all together and said, you know, I'm a real football quarterback and I'm going to make the plays.
Yeah, and really on this win streak since the bye, second four-game win streak of the year for the Browns, by the way, which is crazy. I think they totally butchered that. I don't know if you heard at the end of the broadcast. It was like their first four-game win streak since whatever year where they won their last four games to end the season. I'm like, are we forgetting about the Northern Kentucky through Indianapolis before we play Pittsburgh? How do you mess that up? But anyways, that Houston game. Now I know Houston and Philly were atrocious weather games, so I mean obviously they ran the ball well, but I thought Baker still did a nice job. And obviously against Jacksonville, we already talked about the wide open throws that he misses, and those are just, you know, a lot of those you look at, you know, you can just look at his feet and you're like, oh, no wonder he sailed that ball. It was just not sure, right? But he still made some really, really good, like, when he's on, his arm is one of the strongest. And some of the throws he makes, it's like, oh, yeah, there's the accuracy stuff we would always talk about, because he's really accurate working, you know, some of these throws that he makes, especially to Landry. He really trusts Landry, you know, going back to his rookie year. They never had an issue. They've always been on the same page. You know, and then through this week, you know, Baker was really, really good. But and something I noticed today, too, he did a lot of work from the pocket. This was a game that we didn't see as many boots and rollouts, even though they still utilized it. But usually it's almost like an overwhelming majority of his passes. Yeah. At least it feels like it. That's what they do. And that's great. Baker's completion percentage and the amount of yards that he throws, I think, is only second to Patrick Mahomes when he's outside of the pocket like that. So obviously he's really good and they have the running game to set it up. But today he really put it together. I mean, four touchdowns, all the yards, protected the ball with the exception of the fumble on the fourth and one, which is kind of weird because wouldn't he be down by contact there where his leg's not down? What's the rule on that? I was kind of confused.
I don't know. You know, dude, every rule that comes through, by the way, if you just heard the ESPN thing, it was an ESPN alert. Browns clinch winning season for first time in 100 billion years. But no, you know, between the down by contact stuff and the is it a catch, is it not a catch, you know, I like to think I know what I'm talking about. But at the end of the day, you know, I just am like, see, in that the catch, who was it? That Natson guy caught that fourth down play and I reviewed it. I personally didn't know that if your elbow goes down, that's a catch, right?
Yeah.
I always knew it was 2 feet, one knee, or, you know, something like that. But I didn't know that diving and your elbow scrapes, that's in, and that's a catch. So I didn't know that. So to be honest with you, I don't know. I don't know.
That was his loss. I'm like, yeah, it seems like down by contact, he reached out and he had control of the ball. And then when his arms hit the ground, then he fumbled. I thought usually, like, like a running back extending the ball for a first down and his arm comes down and the ball kind of bounces up. He's usually down.
But, yeah. And since it was at the end of the game, it was within 2 minutes, right?
Well, yeah, so, all the turnover plays get reviewed like scoring plays like that, I'm pretty sure.
Right. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Even that, you couldn't challenge it or anything or do anything like that. Was, but, yeah, you're right.
It was reviewed and it stood. You know, when it's under 2 minutes, it's completely out of Cleveland or Tennessee.
Right. Exactly.
You know, when it comes to a challenge, that's all booth initiated.
Let
me say, my favorite play today was after Jacksonville went right down and scored just a huge.
Yeah.
Bansky was like, fuck you. We're going to come out with a one wide receiver formation, run this like bunch of motion and this weird like boot thing where Baker pivots like he's Luke Kennard playing for Duke or Jay Bill playing for Duke. And just a 75 yard on the out and up to Donovan Peoples-Jones, who totally – we had a couple totally redeemed himself moments. First, Kendall Lamb going full start and, you know, sending just nervous anxiety to me whether Kobe Parkey's now going to make this extra point that's going to be 5 yards longer or whatever it was.
Yeah.
Luckily, he made it. And then Kendall Lamb makes up for it by not getting a pancake, by not keeping Baker safe, but by catching a effing touchdown, which was awesome. And then, which was so epic. And then Donovan Peoples-Jones, he dropped a touchdown. I mean, Baker pumped. Yep. He got open. I mean, he would have walked right in. And I was like, and that was early on, too. It was the first drive. I'm like, we cannot go down the field like this and get field goals. It's going to drive me nuts. Luckily, it wasn't a big deal. But then he catches the 75-yard bomb.
Right. That was also a great play. That was a great play by Baker, because I think in weeks past and last year especially, you know, that play, if I remember correctly, he pumped, right?
Yes.
And if he had thrown the ball when he pumped it and not have restrained himself from throwing it, he probably throws a pick or just an absolutely awful ball. And we're sitting here going, well, it's on him. But instead, he restrained himself. And then, you know, DPJ comes open and he fires it in there and just drops it.
Not only that, even if Baker pumped in the past, he may come off of that, not let it come open, and then he would roll out the wrong way, roll himself into a sack or into having throw it away. Or he would have thrown it and he would have been open, but he would have been so discombobulated and his feet would be in the incorrect position and he wouldn't have made an accurate throw. That time, cool, calm, collected, pumped, feet, shoulders, everything was working, and, you know, Peoples-Jones just dropped it. That was, you know, now we're looking back on it and it doesn't matter that, you know, that's the one positive way that you can spin it, that Baker made, you know, everything was working there. Yes.
Can I tell you my favorite part of this entire game?
Yes.
The complimentary football between the offense and the defense that was played in really the first half.
Yep.
Obviously, you know, defense coming out, getting that fourth down stop.
Yeah.
And then the offense being able to go down and score and putting points on the board, because when you're a team,
touchdowns, not field goals, scoring touchdowns.
Touchdowns.
That's how you put teams away.
Exactly. Because especially Tennessee, who they feed off of Derrick Henry. As we said, he was a zero factor, non-factor in the game. And when you're a team like us, really, you know, who prides themselves on the run and you can't run the ball whatsoever, and you have to pass. Luckily for us, we've got the guys that we can throw the ball to. But you know, Tennessee, who kind of has not really been a huge passing team throughout the year.
And Cleveland's very similar in that way.
Exactly. You know, just building that lead and then them having to play catch up and do something that they're not comfortable with. It's just hard. It's hard for any team in any sport to do that.
It's off of their game plan. I mean, it's going to be tough for anyone to have to drop back there 50 times without a lead, playing you know, from a deficit, even if you're Kansas City and that's what you do, or Tampa Bay and that's what you do, is just throw the ball all the time. But when you're in a deficit, it just makes it that so much tougher. And when Tennessee, like you said, is a running team, you know, it'd be like if Cleveland has to play from behind, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, it's a tough, you know, it's that much more of an uphill battle than it already is.
And, you know, they obviously showed that they're capable of doing that, because they ended up, you know, putting some points on the board. And, you know, Tannehill didn't have a bad day whatsoever. And, you know, they had
feels a nice,
you know, Corey Davis had Corey Davis had a pretty freaking great game, to be honest with you. But it's just, you know, with all that being said, they pride themselves on the run game and not being able to run, having Derrick Henry be invisible. That's what really did it. And I think my underrated player of the game is going to be Mac Wilson. I think Mac Wilson had a few plays where he met, or, you know, came scraping off the edge and Henry was getting outside and, you know, they stalemated, and it wasn't Henry falling forward for 3-4 yards.
No,
it was exactly. Like no gain or TFL.
Yep.
And a couple of really nice pass breakups too from Mac Wilson that I noticed.
Yeah, he did a nice job, and hopefully he's okay. He was evaluated for a concussion today. He had to leave the game. So hopefully he's good, because, you know, it'll be coming up. You know, Denzel Ward, hopefully he's back Monday, especially with that. We get an extra day, right? Is that how that works? Yeah, we get an extra day. So we play on Monday. Baltimore's next. Monday Night Football at home. This is going to be another big test. So, you know, cross it off here. I'm looking at my picks, and I actually picked the Browns to beat Tennessee. So I'm rolling with my picks, man, which we're going to go over here.
Yep.
I
believe if I remember correctly, when I made my picks the first week, I think I had them going 16-0. So
State champs?
Yeah, 16-0 state champs.
My God. No, did you make a prediction? How many games do you think the Browns are going to win?
I predicted anywhere from – I didn't go through, I don't think, and did, you know, every single game pick, but I had them somewhere between 9-7 and 11-5.
Gotcha.
That was my feelings and thoughts going into it.
Beautiful. Well, I'm going to go over my picks right now, the official picks, as always, presented by Chicken Shit, the social drinking card game that you play with strangers. I'm to bring this back. We'll play it at the local 97 snowman. And yeah. I would say this is the perfect game because whether the Browns win or lose, when they win, you go out and you have fun. It's, you know, strangers' expense. You all fun together. But then if you're pissed because the Browns lost, then you just go out there and you just take it out on strangers and just, like, make fun of them to their face drunkenly. So I think it's the perfect game for the Cleveland Browns. They're the perfect sponsor. So here are my picks. Baltimore lost, got that one. Kentucky, Washington, Dallas. Kentucky and Washington, they won, got that one. Dallas missed on that one. Indianapolis Jones got on that one. Pittsburgh lost, got that one. Kentucky got it again. Vegas, they lost, I missed that one. Houston and Philly, I went on a 3-game losing streak, missed all of those. Jacksonville and Tennessee, though, have me back on track. So the Browns are 9-3. I am 8-4, so I'm right there, hopefully. Yeah. I predict the Browns would win 9 games. They're there. And I think that they're going to win at least one more game. They absolutely should win 2 more games. The Browns are staring at – now, I know we want to go week to week here, but, you know, looking ahead, the rest of the schedule, it's Baltimore, Giants, Jets, Pittsburgh. They are staring 11-5 in the face.
And the Jets put up a fight against the Vegas Raiders today.
No one's going to be a letdown. No one's going to be a letdown. No. The Browns are a team that is – right now, they're the number one wild card team. The Browns would be the number one wild card team if the playoffs started today. And, I mean, the Giants are going to put up a fight. The Jets probably hope that they're not going to put up a fight. Maybe they play the second to last week, so maybe they already have Trevor Lawrence lined up and they don't care if they win or not. They just don't. No. Maybe they already have Trevor Lawrence and they just don't want to join the Browns and Lions Club and maybe they try and fight. But, there's no reason that the Browns shouldn't win 11 games. And – you know, we were kind of talking about this a few weeks ago, the way that Baltimore is trending. I know they made us look stupid, but, you know, with COVID and, you know, what they've gone through and things like that, there's no reason that the Browns shouldn't put up a fight and have an opportunity to compete and maybe even beat, you know, Baltimore on Monday Night Football. It's going to be another game for Baker to show up. Tennessee doesn't have much of a pass rush at all. They're in the very bottom of the league in terms of getting to the quarterback. I'm really excited for Baker and I feel much better about Baker, but I want to see him against a team with a pass rush. And there's two of those games left. Baltimore, you're going to get it for sure. Pittsburgh, we don't know because they may already have everything wrapped up. We'll be there, but it might not be much of a game that matters, at least for Pittsburgh.
Live show. We're doing a live show from
first go at the stadium. I mean, there's only going to be about 4 people there. So we're going to have plenty of room.
beautiful.
So this is going to be another big one, another big test for Baker. And again, like Cowherd said, especially since they won today, I want the Browns to win, but most importantly, I want the Browns to stay on schedule, do what they want to do on offense, compete on defense and protect the ball, especially Baker. I don't want him throwing bad interceptions. And if the Browns go out there and look good and compete with Baltimore, I'm going to feel really, really good.
That's easy way to put it. Great way to put it.
That's the way she goes. What Christmas movie do we have tonight? Do we know yet?
I have not made the final decision. Okay. Do we want to let the viewers know about what we've been doing here?
Yeah, give a quick little rundown here.
So my mom is a big Hallmark movie lady.
Hallmark movie.
Yep. If anybody knows what that is, you know, it's the guy goes home to his hometown, meets a girl, falls in love, Merry Christmas, blah, blah, blah.
Whoa, I haven't seen you since high school. Wow.
We remember exactly.
Feelings, man, on the hallway. Exactly. It's those lockers, man.
Yeah, that is exactly what the premise of every movie is. Well, I was, you know, my mom loves them, watches them all the time, just throws them on and then has them in the background while she's doing stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, I go home for Thanksgiving and that's just constantly on the TV. So I'm like, you know what? Screw this. I'm going to totally engulf myself in
you
the Hallmark.
You created ABC Family or whoever does their 25 Days of Christmas. You decided yes. to do it with the cheesiest, worst, romantic, like basically movies where an acoustic yep. guitar is one of the main protagonists or yes. antagonists. Like you're like, right. I'm going to find those movies and I'm going to make my own 25 Days of Christmas lineup. And you have.
Correct.
And I've been a part of it for the last two nights. And let me just tell you, this guy, he knows what he's yep. doing. He's on.
I have gone on. I'm working my way through Netflix right now, yes. finding the all absolute worst romantic movies that I can and watching them and laughing at them because they're so bad.
They're so bad.
It's been a great time. Great right, time.
Perfect. Well, I can't wait to find out what tonight's movie is. Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much for listening. 16 Sundays in Hell, Joe Vore Podcast, week 13. Myself, producer Snowman, who's in season right now. He's always in season, but it's December. So you know how he's rocking right now, being the Snowman. We will talk to you guys next Monday, Monday Night Football, Browns and Ravens.